And so, and those same TAs are in the workshops, right? So they get to meet. So 36 or 40 students actually get to know one group of TAs pretty well over the course of the semester.
Well, yeah, you mentioned the workshops for the first time. I mean, how do you think that's going?
It has its ups and its downs. It depends on the groups that are forming in the workshop, I think, and the problems, right? So the workshop problems are not meant to be rote problems that you can work on your own. They're supposed to be problems that require several people together to figure it out, and I think that bothers some of the students. Well,
but the workshops provide a great opportunity to work as part of a team. I mean, basically, this is what you're going to do when you graduate, is work as part of a team solving problems, and the workshops are excellent for that, something we just can't do in lecture as well. And also, we can attack problems that you just can't do. We can attack complicated problems in the workshops, and there's a certain sense of satisfaction, I think, in solving a very difficult, complicated problem as part of a team.
Right. I mean, so there are two things that frustrate people that students have to realize. One is there is no answer key handed out because it's like real life, right? There's no answer key to life. You have to work the problem and come up with an answer that you as a team are happy with. Mm-hmm. And the other thing is often students don't do part one of the workshop, which is the preparation. And so then these more complicated problems are really tough, unprepared.
But the workshop is a very good scene, though. I've been really impressed. I mean, it's a much smaller, it's just a regular classroom, so there's students sitting at tables, four students each, and they're in these little groups. They really are engaged. A lot of them form study groups made up from their workshop bunch. They work outside of class, and they make very good friends, I think, sitting at these tables. Mm-hmm. And the students very rapidly know who the good students are and who the little more challenged ones are. And but it's a very nice atmosphere. And one of the things that really impressed me is that how the better students really go out of their way to help out the other students. And it's good. I think we try to have a very non-competitive atmosphere where everybody can succeed.
Right, and one of the important things in this large course is that students aren't just learning from the three of us, right? They're learning from each other and from everybody.
Oh, thank goodness.
So there's a lot of learning going on in multiple different dimensions. So you said something about competition. Why don't you say about how we actually grade the course?
Well, yeah, I mean, one of the things, the student always asks, is there a curve for this course? And our rhetorical question is, of course, what's a curve? The students know what it is. But what we do the big first day of class, we basically tell the student our grading scheme. And of course, points is points, but we say, well, if you to pass this course, you need to get 50% of all of our points. And that's the scheme. And of course, the nice thing about this is that the students aren't competing with each other. We have no set percentages of A's or B's, and we're not going to flunk a particular number. It really depends upon how the class does.
So it's an absolute grading scale. So one year, 80% could get A's, and the next year, 80% could get C's. It just...
Well, I'm waiting for that 80% A's. But, some years they do really well.
Right.
I was so impressed this last year. Yeah, I mean, it was a pretty hard final exam. But, we had a lot of people doing really, really well on it. I had some other ones who, didn't do very well.
Right.
But, they also didn't do any work. So, it's not a bad scheme.
No, and another piece of it is, right, in a large format course, the anxiety is that all the emphasis for the grade is on the exams. But because we have clickers, because we have workshops, and what else do we have?
Well, Learning Center.
We have lots of ways for students to get those points. It's not all just on three midterms and a final. So by coming to class and doing the quizzes and doing the workshops, what we see is that the students who do all that pass. It's part of the success.
There's
other ways to show how good you are than just taking an exam.
Well, essentially, the only people who really don't succeed are the ones who simply don't participate.
Right.
Participation is good. I mean, lecture attendance is amazingly high. I had better than 75% every day Some days much higher than that, and that's really good. I mean, particularly when it's so god awfully early in the morning. I mean, 9:30. How's a poor student supposed to get out of bed by 9:30? This is ridiculous.
And the other thing we should say about exams, right? They're not just multiple choice exams. Even though we have 1,000 students, what, maybe a third of the exam?
I brought an exam. I mean, these are booklets. I mean, you look at this; it looks really intimidating. And there is a lot of stuff in here, but you know, we have our Scantron forms, but we also have a place on the Scantron form to put down written answers.
Right, so students have to actually draw structures and write structures and show. They have an opportunity to show us what they know without the constraints of.
That's 1,000 students.
It's good. It's good to have good handwriting. It's good to be able to draw. And then, of course, we get together with the graduate teaching assistants and grade this thing, which, of course, is quite a job.
So over 20
TAs, 1,000 papers. It's quite a scene.
And then Joe has set up this very nice web-based method to give the grades back to the students so that they can see everything that they answered and whether they got it right or wrong. And an advantage to us as faculty is that we never turn back the Scantrons, so there's no cheating on the regrading of
exams. Our students wouldn't cheat.
You should also mention the organic chemistry has this myth of being a course of memorization. It goes back many, many years, but one of the things we do, why don't you show
me the
card? These are student-prepared cards.
This business, I don't know why we didn't think about this decades ago, but is that organic chemistry is a huge amount of information. I don't remember it all. Bill, you don't remember it all. You remember more than me. Nicole doesn't remember.
I don't know any of it.
Nicole doesn't remember anything. But it's a huge amount of information. But we don't expect students to sit there and memorize this stuff. And so for our exams, we have basically an open note system. Well, it's not completely open. We limit it. You get one piece of paper. You get one card. But look at these cards. They are the most filled piece of thing cards you've ever seen.
I like this one.
Some of these cards are beautiful. We have multi colors. It's the students work on these things like crazy. Now, this you say, what's on this card? Well, this is fine print. Everything's on this card. How do they use it in the exam? Ah, this is the trick. The good students don't use the card at all. Why? Because by the time they've made up the card, they know what's on the card.
Right.
They don't need the card. And so it's a wonderful system. It makes everybody feel secure. We can ask, we actually gives us the advantage because we can ask more complicated questions, actually. That's a secret, don't tell the students. But it's a good system, and it makes everyone more comfortable. And it really does help dispel this myth.